What's going on, y'all? I'm here to talk about the really cool buffs and changes I've made to Roaring Moon and my ROM hack, Pokemon Scrambled Scarlet. But before I can get into all of the implications and the reasons I chose these abilities and the moves and all that really fun stuff, I highly recommend if you're a new viewer here and this is your first video of mine that you're clicking on, two things. First of all, shout out to you. I appreciate you clicking on the video. And then second of all, I recommend that you pause the video and give the description a read. It'll give you a lot of important context as for how this ROM hack is balanced, why certain decisions might be made, just overall my general approach, and just a lot of the background basic information about the hack. So definitely give that a read. It's all in bullet point format. It's a lot of text, but it's pretty, you know, if you just read it, it's really not that difficult to understand everything else. So yeah, when you're done with this video, you can check out the Salamence one if you haven't already, and all my other ones after that, if you know this is your something you're interested in. I also recommend you join my Discord server. Again, do all this when you're done with the video. Don't click off because it'll mess up my watch time. But yeah, Discord server, move change guide on the Google Sheet, which is linked down below. Google Sheet has all of the everything you could ever want about the ROM hack in terms of like moves and Pokemon changes and stuff. So give that a look. Yeah, with all that being said. Also, another shout out to my returning viewers. I appreciate you guys very much. Leave a comment down below. Subscribe if you're new, or if you're returning and you haven't subbed yet. I'm trying to hit 2,000 at the time of uploading this. And yeah, Roaring Moon's super dope. Man, they cooked with this guy's design, bro. He's so much fucking cooler than Salamence. Like, Salamence is such a lame ass design. Anyway, that doesn't affect me, you know, the way I'm gonna buff or change the Pokemon, of course. It's just my personal opinion. I might give some guys I really, really like extra shit, but like it doesn't, you know, the guys that I don't like aren't gonna get any worse treatment or anything like that. But yeah, if you go to here, you can pause the video and read what Salamence and Shelgon have going on. I also, again, have a whole video explaining them, and I'm assuming a lot of you are coming straight off of watching that one, so I appreciate you guys who are doing that. But just for anybody who's new here, so I balance, and again, a lot of this might be repetitive at the beginning because it's stuff that I already kind of said in the Salamence video, but essentially, it is every single Pokemon in this game that can evolve like that, especially pseudo legendaries and stuff like that, are balanced so that the middle form is worth keeping over the evolutions. And if they are branched evolution, which a lot of the Paradox Pokemon are and other stuff, they're balanced so that either one is an option. You know, it's not just one is better than the other. One might be cooler than the other. One might be more fun for you than the other. That's all subjective. But in terms of like gameplay, tools that they have access to, balancing, all that stuff, they are definitely all very, like, good and fun to use. So it's up to, it's a subjective, it's whichever one you prefer. Of course, they also have their own advantages and disadvantages. So Roaring Moon has immunities with Wind Rider, tons and tons of new moves from Wind Rider. There are almost 20. Can I count? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, and then technically, like, oh yeah, technically 20, but these four are pretty much never going to be used by the AI. So it's mostly just, I would say, the most relevant ones versus the AI, because it's not an early game Pokemon, right? So most AI teams in the late game are not going to have these weak priority moves because they don't really know how to abuse priority moves properly. But if they do, then of course being immune to Pixie Dust is nice and all. Also, like, if you're fighting, I don't know, the AI and they have a, I don't know, fucking Sada has a Wind Rider, then you can't Pixie Dust it, so that's cool. But or Twister or Frost Flare or any of these other moves. But the main immunities that you actually are caring about is all of, I would say, Air Slash, Feather Ball, because this is a later in the game mon, right? So Icy Wind and Air Cutter aren't going to be as relevant. But Aeroblast, Absolute Zero, Hurricane, Blizzard, Heat Wave, and technically Petal Blizzard and Air Slash. Those are the big ones for the, you know, later in the game. Leaf Storm is a really strong move, but AI doesn't really know how to abuse that very well because they don't know how to switch out once they drop their own stats. So a bit exploitable, so probably won't be on AI very much, if ever. But stuff like Heat Wave, Blizzard, Hurricane, Absolute Zero, Aeroblast, that type of stuff will be common. So being immune to that entirely is great, especially because while you are tanky, you know, a strong stab, you know, 120 base power move, which is what, you know, stuff like Absolute Zero and Aeroblast are gonna sting, of course. So being immune is really good. And then, of course, you get that attack boost, which is a really, really big pro. And you're very fast naturally, you know. Of course, you're not actually as fast as you might think. 120 speed, 121 speed in a competitive sense is crazy, but in an in-game setting where you're not guaranteed a plus speed nature, is pretty wild. Sorry, not as wild at all. So 121 with that guaranteed 20 IV from the eggs, you are essentially hitting 330 speed, which is, why did I put 110? And I knew that's not that high. Not even 105, man. Yeah, you have to be base 101. No, not even base 100 and below is what you outspeed on the AI. So it's not actually as fast as you might think. Of course, you can patch that up with Protosynthesis because you can essentially run. So say you get a neutral attack nature, right? Neutral attack nature, you've got 139 base attack. So you can essentially EV to here you go. You know, put that EV spread in. Actually, no, the IVs are wrong, so even less. What am I missing here? 139, 121. It's modest. That's why. Okay. I was gonna say, what am I missing there? It makes no sense. Okay. I was gonna say, I feels like I have way too many EVs in right now. Anyways, look, you guys don't. It doesn't matter. It's all case by case because your nature will change how this works anyway. But yeah, there you go. There's an EV spread. Boom. Now you get plus speed. And of course, you're sacrificing damage, but you have such high base power moves that a decent amount of the time, it's not gonna even really matter very much. It will matter. Don't get it twisted. I'm not trying to say it doesn't matter, but it's just not as detrimental as like in competitive or something where you're really sacrificing your attack. You're prepping with the specific exact moves that you would want to kill whatever's in front of you with, right? So booster speed Protosynthesis is great. Of course, he's great in sun. He's also got Solar Blade, which is super dope. I love that. That's so cool. You know, also if you got like a really cool Terra type on him, I think that'd be really cool. Like Terra Grass would be fucking sick, or Terra Fire in the sun with Temper Flare being essentially Temper Flare and Stone Edge are both Wicked Blow variants, and the downside of those moves in this ROM hack is that you can't click them twice in a row. So on a sweeping set, it's, you know, for example, with Scarf, you can't just spam those moves, although he doesn't get Wicked Blow or any other Stab Draco Meteor variants. But, excuse me, Stab Wicked Blow variants. Draco Meteor variants, he does have Dragon Ascent, which is physical Draco Meteor, which is, you know, most, pretty much every flying type, pretty much every dragon type that can fly gets that, that is physical. You know, so stuff like Hydreigon, Dragonite, that type of stuff, which is cool. It's very neat move, very cool flavor-wise, you know, for him to just give that big old dive bomb attack. Speaking of dive bomb, he does have that as well, but it's more of a niche option. Obviously acro booster is still good, although you're not guaranteed Terra flying or anything like that, so that's more of an you know, it's still good regardless for coverage, but you're not guaranteed that Terra type. You're supposed to work with whatever Terra type you RNG'd, which is really fun anyways. Personally, I mean, that's how the game's balanced. You can nothing's stopping you from just slapping on Terra flying if you want to go against the intended rules, but this is just what's intended. Yeah, Dragon Ascent. Draco Jet is a really cool priority move. I initially only intended for that to be on stuff like Garchomp and the Lottie Twins, who are like literal jet dragons. But then I was like, when I got the Flapple, I was like, dude, I can't resist. He's got Hustle. Like, I gotta let my goat have the strong-ass priority, you know, Hustle move. And so at that point, I'm like, okay, Roaring Moon can have it too, because he is known. Like, his whole thing is like... Also, I guess I didn't explain the Windrider flavor. Windrider, I mean, I think it should be obvious enough. He's like gliding, right? He's not even really flying. He's gliding. Like if you look at him in the game and in his animations and stuff, he doesn't flap his wings really. He's like gliding. It's like those lizards that glide. You know, that's how his wings are shaped. So I think Windrider is really cool because of that, because he is gliding, not necessarily flying or flapping his wings. So I think if you like shot a big gust of wind at him, he could just kind of ignore it, I guess. Obviously, Blizzard and shit is weird, but that's how Windrider. I mean, fucking Bramble Gas and shit is immune to Blizzard and stuff. So you don't really need to question the logic of that as much. Levitate is great as well when you need it. So you switch to it with the infinite ability changing option, and then, you know, you slap it on when you need that immunity. It's just a nice little once in a while thing that you'll take advantage of. And then, of course, Protosynthesis is very good with booster or in the sun. You can also do manual Sunny Day. You don't need a drought Pokemon on your team, although there are quite a few new drought Pokemon to take advantage of Protosynthesis with, but that doesn't mean that it's like the only way to do it. You know, it's in-game versus AI. You can easily set up Sunny Day and do your own thing. You know, you have switch moves on all your other Pokemon, stuff like that. So in this case, they do get access to Parting Shot. Salamence and Roaring Moon both get that. Shelgon does not. So that's a TM, really cool, fast Parting Shot, utility stuff. I would say Roaring Moon is like more about immunities, and then Salamence is more about like defensive utility, and then Salamence is slower but much stronger with Sheer Force, while Roaring Moon can be stronger with Windrider or a Protosynthesis boost, but those are not less immediate of a boost. You know, those are situational boosts, while Sheer Force is an innate boost. And then, of course, Moxie Scarf is incredible on Salamence. So it's really up to you which of the two you prefer more. I think most people are still going to prefer Roaring Moon, but because he's just, his design is so much cooler. Like, man, they really cooked. He's so fucking cool looking. But yeah, in terms of gameplay, all of them are very good. Even Shelgon, again, I covered that in the Salamence video, so you can watch that one after this if you haven't already. You know, you got your typical like Dragon Claw, Night Slash with Scope Lens, plus other moves like X Scissor, Shadow Claw, Laceration. All of those are guaranteed crit when you're holding Scope Lens, so those are 120 power. You late game, you've got your Brutal Swing and Dragon Hammer, which are both like Dragon type and Dark type double edge variants, so those are really, really strong spammable moves, at least more spammable than other high base power moves. Of course, all the high base power moves for the most part have drawbacks now, Draco Jet included, so you can't click that twice in a row, so you can't slap on like Choice Band Draco Jet and just go to town with that 105 base power priority move. It's an incredible tool. You might have to take it away at some point. I just think it's fine for now to let him just cook with it. I think it's a cool move. But again, I can take it away from him in a future patch if it ends up being much. But I think it should be fine. There's other really strong priority moves. And again, as long as you're not 6-0-ing, spamming Choice Band, Draco Jet, it's not a big deal for me. I would say the main concern would be like sweeping sets. Because keep in mind, Tailwind with Windrider, I don't know how it took me 10 minutes to mention this, but yes, you can Tailwind into Windrider, get plus 2 speed, plus 1 attack. You can run max HP, max attack, and then just get that Tailwind, outspeed everything for a couple turns, and get a bunch of kills. And the beautiful thing is Draco Jet. Actually, you know what's a good question? Does the Windrider Tailwind attack boost go away when Tailwind goes away? I don't think it does. Because I know for a fact, like, you switch in on Aeroblast or whatever, you're gonna get a boost. I'm not sure how that works with a. I'm pretty sure it would stay, but somebody can correct me in the comments if it does go away after Tailwind goes away. But I figured it would probably stay. I would hope so, at least. If it doesn't, then it's less cool. But if it does stay, then you can also click Draco Jet after the Tailwind runs out to get another kill, for example, because you do have a movie laner, you have the move slots for it, which makes moves like this much better, right? Because it's not like you're gonna run it every fight, but when you do want that extra priority, I mean, it's 105 power. It's stronger than Dragon Rush even. So it's stronger than Dragon Rush, but of course, if you want like that raw burst damage, you've got Dragon Ascent or like Scope Lens Dragon Claw, and then of course later in the game you have Dragon Hammer. I might have to push Draco Jet to 65. I think I had it at 65 initially, and then I was like, let me push it back. But maybe I'll put it back up to 65, and just have there be a 10 level gap there, or I can throw Dragon Hammer earlier or some shit. I'll figure it out. Maybe after the video, let me write down Draco Jet, just 55 or 65. Yeah, I don't know. I'll figure that out. But point is, it'll be a late game move regardless, and it's a cool move. He's got other cool coverage. I mean, he's got tons of coverage. I'm not gonna bother even listing every single one. You guys can look at the screen and see what they are. I think some cool, funny ones like Grassy Glide. Again, he's like gliding, so that's why I threw that on there. Arcane Fangs is good for recovery. You can still use him defensively because he's got really good raw defensive. Like 105, 79, 101 bulk is really solid in game, but you can just slap on defense EVs when you need it. So you can run him like, Roost slash Wish slash Parting Shot, that type of defensive crap. You can definitely use him for that once in a while. I mean, is it what you're going to be using a lot? No, but on Team Lock, there's all types of really cool use cases for stuff like that, so that's really fun. Fury Swipes is a cool little move that you can pair with Scale Shot with Loaded Dice. However, Scale Shot is nerfed. Well, it's nerfed and buffed. It's buffed that it can't miss, but it's nerfed in that it is only 15 base power now. I could honestly maybe eventually change it to 20, because it still does require... Honestly, I would say Scale Shot is much more balanced than stuff like Ice Spinner and Flame Wheel, which also give you a speed boost and are 60 base power, because Scale Shot has 15 base power with Loaded Dice is only 60 base power guaranteed. So I might end up changing that to 20, so it's 80 base power guaranteed. Because again, it does require Loaded Dice, but I'll see as the game plays out after the game is released and stuff if I feel like changing it. In fact, I can ask right now in DMs just quickly. Scale Shot. I'll type it after the video. I think I've covered pretty much everything I really need to talk about anyway. Yeah, he's also not a mixed attacker like Solomon, so that's definitely a downside. It limits his options more. Not that it's a big, huge deal, but it is something to consider, especially if you've got like a modest nature, then of course you're going to take Shelgon or Solomon at that point. Shelgon, because it doesn't matter because he's defensive anyway, and then Roaring Moon would not want to be modest. So it's up to you, really. It's up to your nature, your personal preference, your design preferences, your play style, which ability synergizes better with your team, all that fun stuff. So. Yeah. Thanks for listening. Let me know if you made it to the end. Shout out to you if you did. I very much do appreciate you guys if you did. Last thing I want to say is that Draco Jet might end up need to get removed from it, specifically because with Tailwind slash DD, it makes sweeping really easy, because a lot of the anti-setup stuff is like Quick Claw in the back, a single-use consumable Quick Claw, and giving them a priority move that out is really strong, like 105 power, will cheese that Quick Claw and also potentially one-shot that Quick Claw Mon before they can get off the Quick Claw attack, because priority moves go before Quick Claw. So definitely something to consider. So I don't know, might have to remove that in the future, but for now he has it. And if he doesn't, it doesn't really, I mean, it changes things a bit, but he's still got all the other cool tools and stats and abilities and all that fun shit. So yeah, thanks for listening. Shout out to you if you made it to the end. I really do appreciate it. And I always say that in every video, but it really does mean a lot if you do make it to the end of all my videos. So thank you. And I'll be back for more coming up. Peace.